Hello, viewers, and welcome to another episode of Speechless. I'm your host, Evie Alverio, and today we'll be debating the issues that matter. On tonight's show, we'll be discussing technology in the classroom, pumpkin spice, and the summer movie season. It should be an interesting show, so stay tuned. Ready, set, Speechless. Welcome back to Speechless. We have a great show for you tonight, but we can't begin the debates without getting to know our debaters. Please welcome, from the Maria Menounos Manatees, Alicia Parikh and Joseph Gherkin. How are you guys feeling about the debate tonight?
Can't wait.
Excited.
Oh, exciting. And from the Jennifer Coolidge Cougars, Nako Narter and Patricio Gill. How are you guys feeling about taking on the Manatees?
Just thrilled.
Ready to win.
All right. Okay, so now it's time to get into our first topic of the night. Nowadays, technology seems to have incorporated itself into all aspects of our lives, or has it? Despite the huge technological boom we are experiencing in society today, many schools still require students to spend hundreds of dollars on textbooks when they could get e-books at a much cheaper cost. Should tablets and laptops replace the reliable but outdated use of books and paper, or should schools stick to the traditional way of learning? Debaters, have at it.
So, we believe that textbooks, they should be gone.
No.
Textbooks are here to stay.
Well, yeah. I believe on Panto's view because, you know, using tablets, it's tablets versus books. When you use tablets, we save trees, which allows more oxygen in the air. So that's like a benefit for the environment right there.
Oxygen's great, but how great is oxygen really when you're out of breath because it costs so much time and effort and money to replace your easily breakable tablets?
Well, let's consider the fact of a book itself. It's physical, so you have the risk of damaging it with pen, ink, pen is ink, highlighter, and the risk of fire on it.
These are all things that tablets are susceptible to as well.
True.
And at a much higher cost to repair.
Yeah, but you have a database. Ever heard of Google Drive?
No.
But really, we can just upload all of our PDFs or books to Google Drive or any other, possibly like Amazon Prime, whatever they have.
If you use a tablet, then you don't have to carry a backpack with all these textbooks and all this weight on your back, right? So it's better for the kids and like for students because they don't have all this weight like weighing them down all the time.
Yeah, but that's a good point.
Let's think about the people inside the classroom. The people in front of you and have a computer, they're on it. It's a distraction to the people to the back, and it's a distraction to the person using the computer and the tablet itself.
But if everybody's on a computer, then everybody's just going to be focusing on what they're typing the whole time and focusing on listening to the teacher.
That's
so
true.
Is it really that distracting?
It's distracting because once you have the internet available, anyone can go to whatever site they want to look.
But there are ways to monitor that.
That's
like
true.
At one of my past schools that I've been to, they block Facebooks and like Twitter and Instagram. So while you're in the classroom during classroom time, you can't distract yourself. All you have is like typing your notes. So there are ways to monitor it.
Majority of the schools, high schools out there, even colleges and districts, they have on-site routers that students can only access where they can access only academic websites, non-sensitive content.
What if you have downloaded an application on it? I've seen people play Pokemon in class, and it's a distraction to me if I'm behind them. I'm like paying attention to the game instead of the professor. Sometimes it's even more interesting.
To quote Mayor Bloomberg, when you have computers there, then there's the pornography and social media and the distraction of games.
People download pornography and see it in class. It's a distraction to everyone.
That's true. However, you're looking at like just a couple of the negatives. You know, in 2025.
By 2025,
we're gonna have 3 out of 4 persons holding a tablet. So practically most of the people will be having the books in their hands. We're talking about, let's say we have 6 books like this, yay high, versus a tablet, this yay high.
And also you can see the fact that like tablets and like computers are already being implemented in schools. Because at Emerson, for example, the journalism department provides every journalism student already with the laptop with like all the software needed already uploaded online. You can get all your textbooks online. So it's already being implemented in schools.
Well, actually, only about 30% of all textbooks are available online. So if those are the ones that you're needing, then great. But if not, you're out of luck.
This is true.
No, so let's look at the facts. A tablet, a computer, it has a bright screen. It hurts your eyes. After a while, you're just getting a headache.
You can lower the brightness.
That's true.
So
it's still not linked to eye strain, blurred vision.
We're not looking at a screen for more than 2 hours here. It's like we have periods of class for 45 minutes, what's breaks, including.
What if you have like the laptop the whole day? It's gonna start.
Especially
but
in a
think
high
about
school
it
setting,
this way:
you're
like kids are already
hours.
Using their phones all day long. They're staring at their phones all day long, texting, Snapchatting, tweeting. So staring at a laptop, is that really any different? Especially if it's providing academic use, that's
it's
like
not
a good
but
use
it's
of your time.
Continued and also bad still.
But it's already used like a laptop and a computer, and screens are already stared at continuously anyway. So what's the difference?
And we have to include the efficiency of using a laptop and a tablet in the classroom because. A teacher could easily just send a document to the entire classroom without having wasting any paper. Because you know, this day, there are a lot of trees dying because we're using a lot of paper.
That's true, but there are already so many books that have already been printed. Even if we didn't print any more textbooks, there would be a plethora of information available in the ones already created.
And it's also been proven that even though we've had more technology available, the use of paper has actually risen. It hasn't gone down. People are still using paper. Professors still hand out worksheets and
Oh boy, oh boy. Wow, what a great debate. And I'm not too sure which team I agree with more, but thankfully we have judges to deal with that. Please welcome judges Will Connell, Arden Yerkes, and AJ Tierney. Judges, who do you think won this one?
Well, it was a very heated debate. I really did like the manatee's point on how, tablets are more efficient. But me personally, I am pro backpack, and I am also agreeing with the Cougars in saying that it is quite distracting to have laptops in the classroom. I'm going the Cougars.
For me, I thought that the manatees were definitely better prepared. I thought they had a lot more information going into the debate. However, I thought that the Cougars definitely won the debate when they said 30% of all textbooks, only 30% of all textbooks are online. If that's the case, then it's not even up for debate. So I am Team Cougar.
I think that I don't know all the things that I've downloaded in class, and I know I probably shouldn't have downloaded them. So I'm just going to go with the Cougars because I think I should be stopped.
All right, well, congratulations, Cougars. You've won the first debate of the night. But don't worry, there's plenty of time to catch up in our next two debates after this break. Don't go away. Speeches will be right back.
Introducing the stars of Emerson's number one morning show. This is Medina Shehi. She breaks the latest pop culture news. She also recently broke the bench press world record in Germany, twice.
Genetics.
This is Chloe Thibault, always the first to break the hard-hitting news on the local and national scale. Also always the first person to pop up on your Tinder account.
I love meeting new people.
This is Malcolm Kellner, Minnesota native and sports extraordinaire.
It's true.
He was the second choice for the reporter position. Our first took a job at EIV. This is Sean Stackhouse, one of the two dynamic hosts leading the charge of the show. He will say literally anything that is on the prompter.
And I'm Lauren Fox.
This is the real Lauren Fox. She thought she would be hosting Good Morning Emerson alone. She claims there is no ill will between her and the producers. This is Noah. He's lighting.
Welcome back to Speechless. Now, let's get on with our second and arguably most spooky debate of the night. It's that time of year again. Hoodies, scary movies, Tom Brady, and most importantly, pumpkin spice. Jack-o'-lanterns and pumpkin pie have always been a part of New England autumnal tradition. But in recent years, the market for pumpkin-flavored items has begun to explode. From September to November, you can walk into any grocery store and buy pumpkin-flavored ice cream, granola, even popcorn. The fad is not without its detractors, however. Some claim that the trend of pumpkin-flavored items is out of control. So, is pumpkin spice too much or just too damn good? This time, let's have the losing team start. Manatees?
Well, first off, every company has their market team. So with this pumpkin spice flavor in mind, they are taking advantage of the pumpkin spice norm. We have, for example, pumpkin spice Halloween costume, pumpkin spice body fragrance, pumpkin spice soap. Like, come on, honestly.
Things become popular when a lot of people like them. It seems like this is what the people want, and Mark, the man is just trying to make them happy.
Yeah, plus, prices, it helps the market. Like, people buying it, it helps all the shops, it helps the economy having pumpkin spice available everywhere.
Starbucks is pretty happy about it.
Yeah, but do you realize how inflated or saturated that can become?
We're literally like drowning in pumpkin spice things. We have like, we wear it, we eat it, we like smell it. We even make dog chew toys out of it. Like now our dogs are eating pumpkin spice too. That can't be healthy for them.
What? No.
That's where you're wrong, actually. The spices in the pumpkin spice latte are actually four very healthy spices. For example, cinnamon. It's linked to anti-clotting, and it also lowers cholesterol. Ginger, it combats nausea, and it's also anti-inflammatory. Nutmeg helps with digestion, it's a sleep aid, and it combats Alzheimer's. And allspice, it's helped treat and prevent infection, colds, chills, and even bronchitis.
And plus, let's face it, people like pumpkin spice because it's very good.
I actually want pumpkin spice right now. But it doesn't mean that we don't want it, it's just becoming too much. I mean, all the companies across the spectrum is using it. I still want to have pumpkin spice, but I want all the other flavors available.
But
why is that one pumpkin spice such a big offer?
We can have all the flavors and pumpkin spice. It can be one of the like regular flavors. We have chocolate, we have vanilla, we have pumpkin spice. Plus, it gives everyone a reminder that autumn is just around the corner. It's like having turkey on Thanksgiving, just have pumpkin spice and autumn. It's part of a tradition.
Pumpkin spice has actually been around for 13 years. That's longer than gay marriage.
It's a tradition now.
On a federal level.
What do you guys have to say to that?
Well, pumpkin spice is too much if we're talking about it.
13 years, it's tired at this point. Like, it's everywhere. Somebody needs to come up with something new, something different, something original. Like,
and you said it was a costume?
Yes, pumpkin spice Halloween costume.
That's wild.
Yeah. What about chocolate mint? Let's face it, most people don't like chocolate mint. And it's a trend that's been going on for so long. Why is pumpkin spice seen as a negative thing if we have a chocolate mint?
We are not saying it's negative. We're just saying it's too much. That's all we're saying. It's just that, you know, you have three different flavors, and that one thing is getting all the coupons and offers.
Too much for what, though? It's actually helping a lot of businesses, and it's only available to people who want it, and only the people who want it are the people who buy it. Trader Joe said they actually have been expanding how many products they offer that are pumpkin spice, and that's just supply and demand. They offer 70 pumpkin-flavored products as of this year, and that's up from 60 last year. They're doing it because they know people want it.
Ooh, wow, what a great debate. You guys are really spicing up the night. All right, okay, judges, who do you think took this one?
Well, that was another heated debate from our two debaters. While I agree with the Cougars saying, you know, pumpkin spice helps the economy, that was a good quote, and also the statistics you brought out, it's hard to divert from the central fact that it's too saturated, the market is too blown up with pumpkin spice. I gotta go with my girl Maria Menounos and the Manatees.
Well, I've got to disagree with you. I'm going to go with the Cougars because I think that team had a lot of great information, a lot of statistics, and I thought the Manatees were basically just repeating the same thing. It's too much, it's too much. And I just wanted to hear more.
Well, sometimes facts and statistics are great, but what I needed was a really emotional argument. And the Menounos Manatees gave that to me because I went into Starbucks today. They offered me a pumpkin spice, and it hurt my heart.
Well, there you have it. Congrats, Vanities. 1 point for you. All right, we're neck and neck here. And I don't know who's going to win, but we're going to find out when we come back from break. Don't go anywhere.
Wow, our debates are on fire. Ah! Oh no, why did I say that? Ah! Oh no, I'm on fire still and it's so hot! Why am I doing this? Ah! Oh no! I'm still on fire, but one speechless on the Emerson Channel! It's really good and full of action!
Welcome back to Speechless. It's the final debate of the night. Here we go. The summer movie season has come to a silent halt and has left me wondering, how many times did I actually go see Warcraft in IMAX? The answer is not enough. 2016 provided some notable popcorn fare with the likes of Finding Dory, Central Intelligence, and Captain America: Civil War, all cracking the top 10 grossing films from June to August. 2016 wasn't without its duds, however. I'm looking at you, BFG. In the season, jam-packed with reboots, sequels, and a few standout originals properties, was summer 2016 Star Trek Beyond a great time at the movies, or did each outing at the multiplex leave you Ben Hurt? Debaters, first team to say they loved Mike and Dave need wedding dates, gets to begin the round.
Didn't see it. I guess,
Okay, let me start off by saying that out of the top 10 like highest grossing films of this summer, 7 of them were like reboots or like reboots or sequels, okay? And then out of those top 7 that were reboots, all of them made over $100 million. And according to like Rotten Tomatoes, if a film makes over $100 million as a sequel, it's considered like a box office success.
I'm very glad those movies were a box office success, but did you look at the Rotten Tomatoes scores?
Yeah, Finding Dory got a 92%, mm-hmm. Captain America got a 90%, and those were 1 and 2 on the top 10 highest grossing lists.
Did you see the movies?
Yeah, I did.
Did you like them?
I enjoyed Finding Dory and Captain America.
Finding Dory does not compare to Finding Nemo in any level.
Finding Dory made approximately $500 million in the box office.
Yeah, it might be a popular movie, but that still doesn't make it good. Like the.
I mean, obviously the viewers really enjoyed it if they're spending that much money to go see it.
Or was it just one person seeing it many, many times?
That is also very likely.
If one person is willing to spend $500 million, then that would be quite remarkable.
Let's face it, it's a Pixar movie. People are going to go watch a Pixar movie. Last year, we got an excellent Pixar movie. In fact, one of the best Pixar movies in years. This year, we get a sequel.
But it was also an excellent movie that got a lot of money and a really high Rotten Tomato rate.
On average, most sequels make more than 8 times than the original movie. So when you see that sequel, they're making it 8 times better of the box office price.
Yeah, but that's why sequels get made, because they have a built-in audience. That's lazier content than an original score or original movie.
People go and see sequels because that's all they have.
There were also original films that came out this year as well. People go and see sequels because they enjoyed the original and they want to go see more of the characters they fell in love with the first time around.
They're mm-hmm. settling. They want to see the original movie again, and this was the next best thing.
Yeah, plus, the original movies were, most of them were duds. Like BFG, you had
BFG didn't have a sequel.
No. Like what I'm saying, those are the original movies.
And that was based on a book, so.
Like the original movies that came this summer. Like people didn't go see them. We only got reboots. We don't.
But out of the top 10, 3 of them were also originals. So people do go see the originals, and the originals do make money as well.
I read Captain America Civil War, and I didn't even want to go see the movie.
But that's just you.
I don't think so. I think that's where you're wrong. It looked bad. And this is someone who considered the Avengers one of the top 10 movies of all times. And this movie looked horrendously boring, which was a tear for me, and probably a tear for America.
Well, that's in your opinion. I mean, we can't just justify a movie by just one person. We have a whole spectrum of those.
A whole spectrum of dollars is what I'm hearing. I want to know what the American people feel in their hearts.
But are you representing what the American people feel in their hearts, or just what you felt in your heart?
I would like to come forward and represent the entire Jewish community.
I think that the money that people spend represents the entire population, okay, because obviously they're going and they're spending their time and their money to go see the movie.
Again, let's look at the scores. Even though Finding Dory, Captain America, they did okay, we still got movies like Superman versus Batman. In my opinion, one of the worst movies I've seen in my life. We got movies like, I don't even remember what came out this year.
Boring.
Yeah, they're all boring. We had Suicide Squad, that was bad as well.
Suicide Squad wasn't a sequel.
It was still a reboot, but right now we're focusing on whether sequels and reboots
were good in the box office, not originals. And sequels and reboots did do really well in the box office this summer.
Still? No, we're talking about the movie season.
We're focusing on sequels and reboots.
From the past summer season, were the reboots and sequels great? And they were.
What was your favorite from the summer?
Well,
I really liked Finding Dory. Yeah. Brought me back to my childhood.
Also, Now You See Me Too. That was a good movie.
I didn't even know that was a thing. I didn't even know Ben-Hur was a thing. That was
Star Trek.
I feel most people and plus, compared to last year, movies this year made a significantly less amount of money than they did last year.
Actually, that's not true.
Actually,
that is true.
No, actually, that's not true. Movies this year broke box office
records. But ticket sales, no. It's been a downward trend for the past 15 years.
Exactly.
Okay, it is getting pumpkin spicy up in here. But unfortunately, the debate is over. Who is going to be the first team to win this debate this season of Speechless? Judges, you will decide. But first, I think it's time to hear what people on the street thought about our fall-themed debate. Over to you, Aria.
Thanks, Evie. I'm your segment host, Aria Middleman, and I'm on the street today asking Emerson students what they think about pumpkin spice. Is it overused or just too tasty to complain about? Let's see what they have to say. What do you guys think about pumpkin spice?
Overrated.
It's a nice flavor, I mean.
Oh, we have some varying opinions here.
I do like it. I am from Massachusetts, but I'm not one of those New Englanders who's like, pumpkin everything.
Yeah, I totally
I'm not
that.
On the craze, but I will eat it.
I think it's good, but it's overpowering now. They have way too many products. It's kind of scary.
I definitely feel that.
Yeah.
I'm a little bougie when it comes to coffee, so I'm not really a fan of pumpkin spice at all.
Pumpkin spice, it's best left in a pumpkin.
Best left in a pumpkin. Oh, so you don't like any Starbucks drinks with pumpkin spice in it at all?
After pumpkin pie, you can have pretty much everything else.
In a bunch of Starbucks drinks, you know, especially come like the fall season, you're seeing it in so much that's out on the market now. Does it make food better when you eat it? Or are you just like, oh my God, this again? Or?
Well, I mean, Starbucks, I've never had Starbucks.
Really?
I'm a Dunkin's guy all the way. However, I'm not like, I don't think it makes the food worse. I do like spice.
If there were going to be a law that were passed saying pumpkin spice is now illegal, would you be for or against it?
I'd be against it. It's like I don't like it, but I don't have anything against it, you know?
Okay, how about you? Why would you make a flavor illegal? In McDonald's in Japan, they have pumpkin spice French fries. What do you guys think about that?
How does that work? Like, what do they do?
That's it's a little much, you know?
Yeah.
It's taking it a little far.
Yeah.
It seems like we've got some varying opinions out here on the Emerson campus. You know, some people are against it and some people are for it. But when it comes down to it, you can always be too salty, but never too spicy. Thanks for watching. I'm your segment host, Aria Middleman. And don't change that channel. Speechless. We'll be right back.
Good morning, Emerson, of course.
Good morning, Emerson? What's that?
It's the best morning show ever that's on Tuesday and Thursday at 9 a.m.
Wow, how can I work on this?
Yeah, let's get going. Red leather, yellow leather, red leather. Welcome back to Speechless, the final moment of truth. Judges, who won the last debate of the night?
Well, it was 3-for-3 in heated debates tonight on Speechless. I gotta give credit to the Manatees for not only shouting out Now You See Me 2, but for also saying that 7 out of the 10 top grossing movies were reboots and sequels. But I do feel like the Coolidge Cougars retorted by saying they were cashing in on a built-in audience, there wasn't enough original properties, and for that, I'm going with the Cougars.
Well, I gotta disagree. Although I found the Cougars very funny in this round, I think the Manatees were better prepared, and they were ready with the Rotten Tomatoes scores, and they just sounded like they knew their stuff. So I'm gonna go with the Manatees.
Well, folks, I found Dory, and these are my thoughts on Finding Dory. Finding Dory was bad. I think I'm giving this one to the Cougars. To the Cougars.
And congratulations to the Cougars. The last point of the night goes to you, which means the Cougars are the winners. Woo! How does it feel?
Feels great. I feel accomplished.
I can finally go home to my family with good news.
I can finally sleep, fall asleep without crying tonight.
That's always what we aim for. Well, that's all we have for Speechless tonight. Tune in next week for our first live episode, Wednesday night at 8:30 p.m. Until then, stay speechless, everyone.
Of Emerson's number one morning show. This is Medina Shehi. She breaks the latest pop culture news. She also recently broke the bench press world record in Germany, twice.
Genetics.
This is Chloe Thibault, always the first to break the hard-hitting news on the local and national scale. Also always the first person to pop up on your Tinder account.
I love meeting new people.
This is Malcolm Kellner, Minnesota native and sports extraordinaire.
It's true.
He was the second choice for the reporter position. Our first took a job at EIV. This is Sean Stackhouse, one of the two dynamic hosts leading the charge of the show. He will say literally anything that is on the prompter.
And I'm Lauren Fox.
This is the real Lauren Fox. She thought she would be hosting Good Morning Emerson alone. She claims there is no ill will between her and the producers. This is Noah. He's lighting.